as part of my ongoing quest to try different styles of beer from different places around the world and widen my horizons, this is Innocent Guns Lager from Scotland. It says it's brewed with naked golden oats. Ah, shocking. Well, that's quite different than what I'm used to. But I think I can, definitely get into that. That's cool. So about this mail stuff, let's start from the smallest and work our way to the biggest, shall we? So this one says headset on it. Careful not to cut any wires just in case it really is one. Oh, looks like it's a little Bluetooth headset. Interesting. Not usually a fan of Bluetooth, but if I remember correctly, when I ordered this, it was incredibly inexpensive. And yes, who doesn't need another cheap headset for walking the dog and listening to podcasts and stuff? And if I am listening to podcasts with it, it doesn't matter if it's kind of cheesy quality. I'm not listening to symphonies or anything else. The USB charger just plugs into the side there. That's easy. That's not really a charger, it's just a cable. And then we have three buttons on it. A power and telephone button, a minus volume, and I guess skip forward, and a plus volume button, and skip backwards. Or is it the way up? I don't know. And any of those three holes there, can you see them? Yeah. Are presumably the microphone. And then these things on there, it's flat wire, but it's not very flexible. It's kind of stiffy, actually. One is longer than the other. Do they say left and right on them anywhere? Not really. But I think that's the right one. Let me just try these on here. Yeah, this is the right one on the short wire. That's the left one on the long wire. So if I power it on, let's see if you can hear it. I don't know, I wasn't listening. Anyways, it's making some blinking lights and doing things, but I think I'm going to give it a full charge or charge it while I'm doing the video, and then I'll pair it with something other than the phone that I'm using to record this, and we'll see if I can get anything out of it. Magnet wireless in-ear sports earphone headset headphone for iPhone, Samsung, or, you know, anything that speaks Bluetooth. I got this from A_Cumming868. They are currently selling it for $5.93, but back when I bought it, it was $3.22 with free shipping. Of course it was. This one took 78 days to get here, and I ordered it back in March. So that's a little long, but I guess for mid-pandemic in China, that's not too horrible. So the back of the two earbuds sticks together magnetically when you're not using them. So you can look cool, like this Justin Bieber impersonator here. Sure, that makes sense. And the specifications. Various colors, 75 milliamp hour battery, charging time 1.5 hours, talk 3 to 4, music over 5 hours, and standby 60 hours plus. It's based on the Jerry chip, whatever the hell that is. It's Bluetooth at 2 gigahertz. Yes, of course it is, because that's Bluetooth. Bluetooth wireless distance less than 10 meters. Best call, less than 10 centimeters? Really? Okay. Packaging includes 1 Bluetooth headphones. Yes. 1 USB charging cable. Yes. 2 times pair of earbud tip. Different sizes. No, there wasn't a spare set in there. There was just the one set. Okay. And 1 horribly written user manual. Yes, exactly.
I guess I should have looked at the little sheet of paper that came with it, because it is the instruction for use. Yeah, volume up, volume down, use the volume up, volume down buttons. Whatever. The English is a lot more broken than what I just read off there, but you can get an idea based on that. Anyway, next thing in is module. Always a popular choice. Huh? Oh, this is a little device for testing And for testing ATX power supplies, I plug the ATX power supply in there, power it up. But more than testing it, really these are used to turn an ATX power supply into a low-budget bench power supply, which will give you minus 12 volts to ground, plus 12 volts to ground at a fairly high current, plus 5 volts to ground, and plus 3.3 volts to ground. All these actually at a high current, except for minus 12. That's usually not a ridiculously massive current, but you don't tend to use it that often. I'd kind of like to show you this thing powered on and give you a bit of a demonstration of it, but out of all the power supplies that I have kicking around here, either they're not compatible, they have a much older than ATX standard connector, or they have a non-standard connector such as the old compact style, or they're just non-functional because that's how I got my hands on it. But just so you don't feel completely ripped off, here is my very first homemade power supply built out of an old ATX power supply, as you can see. And I basically just did or duplicated what this is onto here, cut the wires short, and mounted them on top. There's the common ground. That's one thing. This has got grounds available separately for each one. I mean, it's all the same ground electrically, but it's conveniently located. This one, I just went cheap. So that should be negative 11.02, minus 5 volts, plus 5 volts, plus 12 volts, and plus 3.3. So it's exactly what you'd expect. Actually, this guy doesn't break out the minus 5. Not all modern power supplies have that. That's an older voltage that tended to be used for what, the floppy drive, I think it was. Now, this is just an old generic power supply, but this is the kind of current handling you can get out of even an old one. Like 20 amps on the 3 volts, 30 amps on the 5 volts, 10 amps on the plus 12. Less than an amp on the minus 12, though. And the 5 volts, like I say, you won't find that on a modern power supply. Probably, maybe you will, I'm not sure. Anyways, that's only half an amp too. One piece is XH-M229 desktop PC power supply, ATX transfer board power supply test module. I got it from CCTV 008008 and I paid $3.98 Canadian for it, but as you can see, this guy isn't selling it anymore. So I will link you, as I often do, to this search, which brings up a whole bunch of them from a whole bunch of different sellers. Okay, next one in, we have... Oh, this one came from the dropshipping warehouse in Mississauga, so I don't know what it is exactly. This is another string of 50 WS 2811 controlled LED lights. This is the same lights that I based my, that I used for my Christmas lighting project last year. I'll put a link up in the corner to that if you care. I used three strings of this, and I just saw these for a good deal, so I figured I'd grab another bundle of them. Always handy to have. 50 pieces WS2811 LED pixel addressable 12mm light RGB string IP68 for Christmas decoration. I bought these from Acloral, I guess it's pronounced. This isn't the exact listing, but he doesn't have the exact listing still up anymore. I paid $13.99 for these, Canadian dollars, of course. It took 28 days to get here. Sorry, I can't even read my own damn writing. It took 22 days to get here. And yeah, I paid $13.99 Canadian. Now, this is the best price that he's got for them, $13.99 American or $18.50 Canadian plus shipping. Anyway, these are slightly different. These ones have black wires. Mine have multicolored wires. So these are a little bit fancier, actually. But they're the same thing. So basically, they're the same thing, or almost the same thing functionally, as the NeoPixel or WS2812. These ones, instead of having the chip embedded in the LED, it's on a separate little circuit board, all heat shrinked in to make it weatherproof. So the WS2811 is the actual chip that's doing it, and then there's an RGB LED attached to it.
IP68 waterproof. I don't know. It's got heat shrink and hot glue on it. Maybe, maybe not. Anyway, yeah, it's 7.5 centimeters between the lamps. And the ones that I got, I'm 99% sure run on 12 volts. The existing ones I have definitely do.
Next in, we have, oh, another one that came from that same Canadian drop shipping warehouse in Mississauga. That's always an even bigger mystery. Not that the customs declarations are honest, but, you know. What is this? Oh, it is a package of a bunch of breadboards. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Let me just cut these open. So it's, oh, and there's some chips with it too. Oh, okay. So these are 5 of the kind of half size breadboards. There's the full size ones, but they work the same. And I find that these little guys are often quite handy to use. Is this one that plugs in easily or not? That plugs in fairly easily. Where's my other? You never find jumper wires when you need them. Yeah, those plug in fairly easily. Not the absolute smoothest, but certainly better than the worst ones I've ever had. And as standard, they've got the sticky backing on them if you need it. I personally don't use it, but if you need it, there it is. So there's 5 of those, and some chips in there too. Didn't even mention that. What are these guys? Ah, I didn't need them all out. Oh, these are Atmel ATTINY13s. Okay. These are the baby brother of the ATTINY85, which is the brains of the operation inside the DigiSpark chips. So this is just, these are super inexpensive, which is part of the reason I got them. They're almost cheap enough that you can put them in projects to give away or one-time use projects or whatever. So that's probably the main reason that I got them. They are a little bit lower on memory and a little bit lower on power than the ATTINY85, but for small little projects, that's not a bad thing. That doesn't bother me at all. Let's just see, just for giggles. No problem at all.
5 pieces, mini solderless prototype breadboard, 400 point tie points, 85 by 55.8.5 millimeters. I got this from Galaxy Electronics 2015. Back when I bought it, they were going for, oh, the price has actually gone down. I paid $12.54 for the 5 of these with no shipping. Okay, so that's almost the same then with the shipping price. But that works out to $2.50 each Canadian, which is a pretty damn good deal for these things. And they're such a handy thing to have around, there's no reason not to buy them 5 at a time. And the other thing in the same package from Galaxy Electronics 2015 is 10/50 pieces, the new original ATTINY13A-PU DIP-8 AVR microcontroller. I got 10 pieces rather than 50. I paid $10.42 Canadian for these, and again, they had free shipping at the time, so that's pretty much a wash. That's pretty much a dollar each for a microcontroller. Yes, a dollar each for a microcontroller. Anybody who's as ancient as me, that is just an amazing, amazing price for something that can do all kinds of stuff for you.
And now, the big one, which is complete mystery to me. It was sent to my post office box by one of you generous viewers, another Canadian viewer. So let's open this and see what I have been sent. At this point, there's only one person who knows what this is, and that's the person whose name is hidden under that piece of tape there. Bubble pack. Thanks for the videos, Dan. Well, thank you, Dan. I see stepper motors. Ah, I see stepper motors with larger shafts on them. The stepper motors that I have been using for my little project, where's one here? Are surplus that I got from some scrap pieces of equipment at work. Literally dumpster dive, but anyway. These have 3 millimeter shafts on them. They're lengthy shafts. These ones have a much more stout shaft on them. I'm going to call that a 5mm shaft. It's amazing the difference 2mm makes, but that is a much more substantial, thick, chunky shaft. So there's two of them. And then there's more of them. Holy hell, Dan, what have you done? That's... Wow. Okay, let me get these all out on the bench here. Wow. 8 NEMA 17 5mm shaft stepper motors. Huh. These are air packs. There's the part number, whatever. These are 6 volt, 18 ohm, 1.8 degree per step. That would have been really useful information to have written directly on the back of the salvaged ones that I've got. Are these new or are these used? Hard to tell. They look like they're in good shape. Any of them that I can spin the motor on, I don't feel any problem with the bearings. I'm kind of overwhelmed here. Now I have to decide, do I want to swap that in place of these ones in this project? Huh. I'm not sure. They're standard NEMA 17 motors, so they're obviously going to fit into these printed mounts that I made. Yeah, no problems there. But do I want to redo all these pulleys? I'm not sure. What do you guys think? Or should I come up with another project for these these motors? That's crazy. Thank you, Dan. That's incredibly generous. I appreciate that. I'll try and do something cool with those to honor the gift. That's awesome. And here is the contents of today's Mailbag Monday haul. And quite the haul it was, too. Before I get into the wrap-up here, though, I promised you we'd play with this thing once it's charged up. And now it is. So now I've got it paired with my tablet here. And this isn't going to be perfect because I'm just holding a microphone up to a speaker, but I'm just going to play something from the YouTube free music library here and see if you can hear that. I've got it in my other ear and I don't think it sounds all that great, quite honestly. Just for comparison, here's my daughter's old broken headphones. And I'll do the same thing. I'll just hold it up to the microphone of the phone and we'll see what that sounds like to you. I think even just that sounds a lot better. And just for comparison, I will play some of this just at the very end of the video after I sign off, just so you can hear what it really sounds like. I mean, for spoken word, that will be perfectly adequate. And for the, was it $3 and something that I paid for it? I can't complain too much. I could pay $2 at Dollarama or something for wired ones that are pretty much the same quality. So there we go. Anyway, now that that's looked after, and yes, the little magnet thing does work. Yeah, so travel times. I guess I should do that, right? Everybody likes to hear that. So the breadboards and the microcontrollers took 15 days to get here. The LEDs, even though they came from Mississauga, took 22 days. The power supply thing took 87 days. And the earbuds took 78 days. Ordered variously between April, March, May, June. And in case you're wondering, yes, I am experimenting with different coasters. I haven't gotten rid of the cool little electronic one that I have from Simple Electronics, but I'm experimenting. I don't know. What do you think? Anyway, thanks for hanging out and checking out what I'm up to. I appreciate that. Thanks, as always, to my Patreon supporters who help me buy this stuff and buy me a beer now and again. That is greatly appreciated. Thanks so much to Dan for sending in all these motors. I'm overwhelmed. I truly am. And as always, thanks for watching. I'll talk to you later. Oh, yeah, and here's that bit of music just coming up right now.